right, welcome everybody. You are in the tip of the technology iceberg session. Before we get started, I'm Bob Medved. I'm a proud member of the MVP Business Solutions Group and joined by some panelists here, which I'm going to introduce to you right now. Okay, from left to right, from Audi of America, Mark Allen, Collision Programs and Equipment Specialist. From Toyota, Eric Mendoza, Assistant Manager, Collision Repair and Refinish Training. From Mazda North America, we have Richard Salceda, Project Manager of Product Quality. And from asTech, we have Doug Kelly, who's the CEO over there. So give him a big hand for helping us out today, guys.
Thank you.
Okay, well, you know, as we all know, if you've been around, if you've been reading articles, we've been talking about pre and post scans over and over and over again. And we're not going to ignore those today, but we're going to talk about a little bit more critical issues that we think are bigger issues facing the industry. And one of them is going to be the importance of following repair procedures, how to access those procedures, and how to get the training you really need to perform the repairs the right way. We're also going to discuss advanced driver assistance systems, ADAS, and how that comes into play during your everyday repair process. We're going to be talking about correct diagnostics and recalibration of these systems and how vital that is to a quality and safe repair. We encourage you to ask questions. This is a conversation between you and these guys. Okay, I'm just here to say hi. Everything else is up to you. So we really appreciate it. We had a lot of questions last time. Hopefully we'll have more this time. Okay, well, let's get started. And we want to start with repair procedures. So does anyone there have a repair procedure question for any of these guys?
The question is about time studies, and I'm not sure that I didn't hear anybody from CCC or Mitch or one of them, but can you guys tell me something about how they're conducting time studies to affect the data on some of the, on CCC, Mitchell, and some of the other programs.
Okay. Good, Richard.
Yes, I can tell you exactly how Mazda conducts time studies, and then maybe we'll talk about how CCC, Mitchell's, AutoTech do theirs. Our time studies start off in Japan. So what they do is they actually do one repair, no time. They do another repair, take time, another repair, take time, and they average those three repairs. Then we publish those for our mechanical times and body times. Should that customer, which is a technician, have a question, he's able to submit to Mazda a time study review. Say there's a discrepancy somewhere and he feels there's more time needed. We review that, and if we find it incorrect, we will correct it, update it in our database, and then allow that additional time. That's how Mazda does time studies. There is thought and process over it. It's not just somebody waking up and says, oh, I remember that. That fender just takes 0.8. No. There's a logical method of doing it.
Yeah, I think there's similar methodology between all of us in that. And there are assumptions that go along with that of level of training and capability of the technician doing it. And then I have to believe we all factor in some dealer profitability.
Sure.
So that it's, you know, it's not an absolute half hour at 5/10. It's probably maybe a little bit more time allotted than it actually takes to do the function.
So your question was brought is, you feel the times there are inadequate, or there's a reason for your good question?
My fear is that, you know, time studies are kind of going away. The physical, actual time studies are going away, and they're using more, they're averaging these labor times instead of doing physical labor studies.
Maybe, Eric, you want to comment about what Toyota's doing with the predictive estimating.
So establishing times in the estimating systems, they all have their own ways to do it, right? Mitchell has one way, AutoTech has a way, and CC. I would hate to speak on those ways because I'm not educated enough to be confident 100% in what I say. I'll go out on a limb and say I think from what I've heard that, and please someone help me if you can, that Mitchell and AutoTech are doing their own time studies to come up with those times. So Bob asked me to speak to Toyota recommended repair procedures. How many people in the room are using Mitchell's systems? All right, so about the same as the last group, we have maybe a handful. In that system, Ultramate, there's a separate tab, Toyota Recommended Repair Procedures, for Toyota vehicles, which will bring in all the repair information needed for that repair. So you click on hood, it downloads all the parts, it also downloads the repair information on that hood. If the vehicle has a millimeter wave radar sensor in it for the cruise control, automatic cruise control function, or any of those LDAS functions, it pulls down the calibration information for that. So Toyota Recommended Repair Procedures already in Ultramate is pulling the times, pulling the parts, non-reusable part information out of the repair manual, pulling the repair information all during the estimate process. So it's trying to make it more convenient for you to receive the repair information.
Okay, thanks. Anything else? Yes, right here.
Obviously, you guys can only speak for you, the manufacturer you represent, but why, in my opinion, is there such a problem getting position statements and recommendations on welded on structural parts being used? Where my position in my shop is I don't use them. I don't use a used quarter panel or frame rail or anything welded. We use a resistance welder, we use new parts. But there's a lot of resistance from the insurance companies, but the thing is we don't have support from the manufacturer saying, well, this isn't a good procedure. We have bits and pieces, but nothing real specific from the manufacturers. And in my opinion, drilling a pinch weld and re-welding it, re-grinding it in the same spot, heating it over and over, it's not a good repair. But we don't have the support we need from the manufacturers saying, we don't recommend this.
OEM one stop. So, I hate to say, my friend, you are incorrect. We participate in the OEM collision roundtable, and certainly everyone here on the stage does, and if you see the screen there, it does have position statements that are produced by all the participating manufacturers that care to put them there. We do have position statements that are squarely faced against that. By the way, we share it with the insurance companies as well. So there is, at least on corporate level, knowledge of these position statements and how they affect the repair process. But this is also where you can go to find every OEM that is on here. You can get their repair procedures if they're published. So these are links live to their own networks, and you can pull them off of there. Now, the caveat of that is some of us have to charge for it, and that's based on our franchise agreements with our dealers. When the dealer buys their franchise, part of it is a data package, and we have to charge them. Franchise law says we can't charge you nothing and charge them. We have to at least charge something. So there is a subscription, and typically it can be a day, a month, or a year. That subscription gets you repair procedures not only for collision, but mechanical and electrical. So this stuff is available. You just have to go find it. We tried to make it easier for you. And here's the thing. How often do you check repair procedures?
On every car, or through all that, or, and I will go to OE sites as well. I have some subscriptions.
Okay, so all data is a good product, but not to bash them up. At least you're using them. Here's the thing. All data typically takes the repair information that's published when a vehicle first comes out, and it stays there for a very long time. We do running production changes, and repair procedures change over time. And if you're not in there on every vehicle on the OE site, you're not repairing the car the right way, chances are. So you need to be in there on every vehicle on the OE site and look to see what's there. To Eric's point and to the question earlier, we can't speak for what the information providers include for the repair procedures. We also can't talk for them in what they have as included operations on P-pages. When you go in there, you can see exactly what's required to do what you need to do, and you need to adjust your game accordingly.
You know, this brings up a really good point about accessing repair procedures for every single job. And at CIC, the last CIC meeting, there was an OE rep there, not on this stage or in this room, so I can talk about him, that actually stated that in a recent survey they did with their own technicians, that only 20% of their technicians are actually pulling down the repair procedures on every job and using them every single time. The rest of them, not so much. So I'd like to have you guys comment on that, and what can be done to get better results of people actually pulling these things down on every single job?
I think once you really look into our repair procedures in that website, the actual links, you have to click on the actual link. And what that link takes you to is the individual OEM repair site. It's the same repair site that our technicians use. You just get into it in a different way. Once you see the value and the contents of that information, it should only increase your usage and participation, and you will no longer repair vehicles, especially the newer vehicles, more complex, without doing that as your first step. And that should, you know, increase the, quote, 20% usage.
I think the support for all of your repair procedures is in the documentation that we provide in the repair manuals, not exclusively the position statements, all right, but the repair manuals. The repair manuals tell you what you're supposed to be doing. The sectioning locations that you're referring to, I'm not sure which manufacturer, but the sectioning locations, they're in our repair manuals for our vehicles for all of the available parts. And where there is an exception, maybe the repair manual doesn't include every piece of information, our OEM training is available to you. So you come to training, you use the repair information that's available. We will produce position statements and technical bulletins for Toyota crib bulletins, collision repair information bulletins. We will produce those for things where it's not in the repair manual and we need to set a position on something. You need to be going to the repair manual. You need to be participating in the training that we offer. And I guarantee you that via something printed or via a phone call to one of our instructors or via a class that you attend, we will tell you how we want that repair performed. Beyond that, you know, how you choose to perform it, it's in your hands, but we will definitely give you a...
I think a lot of people are going on position statements as that's why I check first. That's what I want to check to see what their position is. But you made the point, Eric, not too long ago in some publication that mostly all the information you put out in a position statement is actually in the repair procedure itself already. So you're just duplicating. You want to talk about what you're doing with that effort?
Yeah, we've seen position statements being referred to over and over and over again. Oftentimes we put out crib bulletins, aka position statements, that it's a notice. It's a, hey, did you know that on hybrid vehicles you need to be using special refrigerant oil? You know, that's kind of a duplication of effort, because if you go onto the repair manual in the first place, if you were using the repair manual for that, for your repair information, you would have already known that. So you're going to see Toyota and Lexus trending away from repurposing, from duplicating the information in quote unquote position statements. Where there's repair information available. We're here, we're gonna continue to make the push to get you all to raise from that, we'll go with that 20% number. You know, we haven't performed a study, but 20% of repairers, 20% of the people fixing our cars using our repair information to make those repairs, that's terrifying, you know?
Darren.
So guys, I think the elephant in the room is this, and I've been talking about this for a while. I mean, we are a dealer group, right? And all my shops are certified in all their brands and all their manufacturers. The problem is when are the OEs and the insurers going to get together to make an agreement on what they're going to pay for and what they're not. I mean, the toughest thing today is a scanning issue, and Doug will tell you that. I mean, we're rolling that out in our own organization right now, and there's insurers like, well, we're not sure if we're paying for that. So when it comes to your repair procedures, I think predictive estimating was unbelievable, but getting them to pay for that, that's a no-go. So really what needs to happen, and I'd like to hear your guys' opinion, is how in the world are you ever going to bridge that gap to make it where they understand this is what needs to be done and they're willing to pay for it?
Well, I think you're asking us to beat up the bully in the back of the room for you.
No. Hey, you and I have been on a lot of panels together, Mark. It's not the bully in the back of the room. It's the reality of they don't want to pay for it.
We very actively are engaged with the top 10 insurers and a bunch of the smaller insurers. I fly back tomorrow night into Newark, drive back down to Virginia, and I'll be met on Thursday afternoon by another 30-some-odd GEICO folks. It's an agreement that we have that they're coming into our training. I have better ability to affect change with the insurance community who's willing to talk to us, and it's a smaller group compared to the auto body industry than I do with the auto body industry. I've actively been in State Farm working with them, and I know my colleagues here are doing the same thing. We're having these conversations. It does come down to regional management and decision making, and that's something that has to be tended to. But you have a responsibility to educate those people on that level as a certified repairer. And if need be, then call us in to help facilitate the conversations. There's a lot of education, but the fact of the matter is, I probably see as many insurance people as I do repair technicians.
I'll add in on this that we've had all top 10 carriers down to our operation in Plano. We actually worked with iCar behind the scenes to build a curriculum on diagnostic scanning. 18 months ago, there wasn't anything in their training courses to deal with that. We actually held summits, I think we've held three of them now, with carriers and repairers to flesh this out, to start talking about it in a more open and direct fashion so that we can demystify some of what's being discussed and deal with the fact around it. Dan Young, who's on our team, does a lot of work behind the scenes, helping to bridge those gaps between local or regional knowledge and home office. I can tell you that carriers at the most senior levels are aware on this particular issue. The need do care deeply about the car being fixed correctly for liability reasons. Many cases, they're the same carrier that has that vehicle after it leaves the shop, so they want it to survive the second accident, of course. But there is a incubation period that takes place between when an idea is created and how it gets implemented. And the rate of that change, which is, I think, what Mark was referring to, and I see the same thing, Darren, I see it happening faster collectively on the insurance side than I do on the repair side. I have friends, many friends in the collision side. I spent my entire career on the shop side. And I have friends of mine who want to debate with me the concept of doing pre and post scans. And it's astonishing, right? Yeah. But I'll go into markets and I'll have that guy trying to do it right, and there'll be 39 other shops in his market doing it the other way. And the carrier will use that as the argument and say, you're the only one in your market that's asking me to do this. That's not an acceptable response, by the way. Just because 39 people did it wrong doesn't mean the one person right shouldn't get paid. But what I'm saying is we, as repairers, have a huge task ahead of us educating those that aren't in the room today, which is why this is being videotaped, which is why you see us out speaking and working with all these different organizations. We got to carry this message to the market, and we have to have this kind of an awakening that the cars we're working on today are wildly different than the ones that we even saw just a couple of years ago.
Yeah. I want to put another viewpoint of this. Your question is most definitely interested, important, and that's a topic of the future. The insurance companies, even though we do deal with them, and they're not bad people, they did not design the car, they did not build the car. So with these vehicles getting very complicated with much more accident avoidance equipment, modules, it's going to be to their best interest to respect the repair procedures. Now, I'm not saying they're going to pay for everything. Of course, you know, they're in a whole different segment of the industry. But they're looking at these vehicles now, and they're actually wanting to converse with the OE because we need to meet closer in these grounds of uncertainty as far as who pays, what pays, and so forth.
I have two things to say about this. One is, I think you should know that insurance companies regularly come into our training, regularly reach out to us to ask us what our repair procedures are. We readily give them all the same information that we're giving repairers and anybody else, other trainers in the industry. We're sharing the same information across the board, freely, openly. We actively try and bring people into our training, into our information, to give that to them. Last week we had folks from State Farm headquarters attending our non-structural body repair techniques class and our advanced hybrid systems techniques class. So the second thing that I want to say is, personally, I hope that we don't get to a place in this world, in this industry, where we're making repair decisions based on what will or won't be paid for. That repair decision should be made on what does it take to get this vehicle back to an acceptable specification.
Well, you know, I think let me ask one more comment. First and foremost, we're all on your side. We want to repair the car per the OE. I mean, I represent the OE, so I have a vested interest, and I think everybody in here feels the same way. I'm glad to hear that these insurers are getting more involved, because there's a lot of pushback, you know. And again, we're not trying to cheat anybody, but they owe the customer, and they owe them to put it back in pre-loss condition, right?
Sure.
And so that's just part of that whole procedure, and it's been going on because the first thing that comes up is severity, right? And what's the insurance company's biggest important thing? Quality, speed, and cost. Right, when you look at it. So we're on your side. I'm on your side personally. I appreciate what you guys are doing. It's just, you know, we have to be prepared, obviously, to protect ourselves so we can stay in business.
Sure.
So I have a couple comments to follow on with that. The largest employers of actuaries in the country are U.S. military, U.S. government, Las Vegas, and who? Berkshire Hathaway?
Yeah. Sure.
Okay, so they're always looking at profitability. So are you, so are I. We're all obligated to the same customer at that point of impact. And we either pull together as the award-winning team or we fail miserably. And I've been saying this for years, and the fact of the matter is, when you have to step back and look at what the repair procedures are, it's not just something that we threw on paper. We crash a large number of cars, we go through, we take a subset of those cars, they go off to service engineering. Service engineering looks at the design engineers and go, what the hell were you thinking? I can't fix this because you built it this way. They have their discussions, and then we come up with repair procedures that are then crash tested to validate that the structures are as strong as they were originally. Everything is documented, at least from our perspective, in terms of equipment used, product, whether it's adhesives or paint products, whatever the case, it's documented in that repair process. And we're saying so heavily, you need to follow this because it will give you a repeatable outcome. The welders we use, those were all tested. How that weld was done was based on the algorithm that was used with the technology in that machine. So we can only come back and say, this is how we know the repair the car back to that structural soundness, the way it was designed. And it has to be expressed to repairer and insurer on how to go about doing that. But yeah, we're very proactive in having people come through. And Larry, you were there the day we had lunch from Geico come through. So they're very interested. I think what the call to action here is some discipleship on the part of the folks in this room, going back to not only our insurance carriers, but the people that you're being compared to. Rich made a good point, see the empty chairs back there? Those are the people you need to go talk to because they're not here. You need to change their mind because you're being compared to them.
Question.
I just wanted to touch on, I think it was the gentleman from Audi that said, if we're not getting the information or if we can't go back to the insurance company and explain to them what we need, we go back to our dealer, and half the time the dealers don't know the proper procedures. And so then that's always a challenge when we're trying to repair the vehicles properly and our dealer doesn't even know.
OEM one stop, and we're here. We field, all of us field phone calls from insurers and repairers alike throughout the work week on how to get repairs done. I think I speak for myself, but I think the sentiment is similar in that every Audi is my Audi. So that means that I'm going to try and help that customer. And there have been cases where shop in the middle of nowhere wound up with an Audi and I need to take care of my customer. I'm going to give them all the repair procedures. I'll print them off because I'd rather have it repaired the right way following the procedures than not. But it's a phone call away.
Yeah, this problem with not following OE procedures doesn't stop with independent shops. It goes up through the dealership level. Everybody knows that.
Sure.
It's an industry problem, not an independent collision repair industry problem.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, just to clarify, then I'll go ahead and make my statement. Did you say one of the customers notified the dealer and the dealer didn't know about the repair procedures?
Sorry, we're trying to prove something to our insurer so we can get paid to properly repair the vehicle.
Yes, correct.
Then you go back to the dealer to start with, and the dealer doesn't even know.
Right. Now, I will make the following, is that, I don't know about my friends here from Audi and Toyota, but most of Mazda vehicles are repaired, and you're going to be surprised, not by our Mazda organization. Most of them are repaired by you. You repair most of our collision repairs. That's why it's so important that you are aware that we back you up, that we have these information available, the websites, the training, etc. You are my audience, the majority of my audience. Of course, our dealership is our franchise, is very important to us, but speaking specifically about body shop repairs, you're my audience.
I mean, the reality is that as repairers, you need people that are independent, trusted, and verified that can go in and help bridge the gap in some of these conversations. Because, you know, both parties are trying to accomplish what each is being tasked to do, but neither really understand today's automobile. That car you're getting today can change, right? So, you know, model year change, it was every 2 years for bumpers, every 4 years for fenders. Now you're seeing electronics get added onto cars mid-cycle. You're seeing it added throughout the course of the year. You're seeing companies like Tesla go and do updates to cars and actually add features after the car's been delivered. So the truth is you're at this challenge of trying to figure out what you're looking at and how to fix it. And so I think, you know, having access to OEs like PPG's done here, having access to folks like iCar and Verifax, inclusion, I mean, I can give shout outs to a whole bunch of people, but having trusted partners, in my opinion, is a repair's best friend at this point.
Here's another thought, and I'll ask Bob, because we shared past living life down on the farm. Most, if there's a field estimator that has a question and about a technical question about a repair, what are they to do?
They contact a specialized unit we developed at State Farm to help share repair information with them so they can share it with the shops. It's called the crash unit. Yep.
So most insurers have some form of a crash unit or technical unit that can look up the repair procedures, and there is an escalation process. They also have access to us, and we're very proactive in fielding calls from them. So there's a lot of support out there, is I guess what we're trying to say. It's just, you know, being able to access it and ask, right?
The reasons for people not knowing, being aware of, or understanding the repair procedures are abundant, right? For the dealership that you referred to, maybe they don't do collision repair work, they don't have a collision center, they don't understand or go into the repair manual for the same types of procedures. Maybe for some of the independent repair facilities, it's a misunderstanding or a misconception of what the repair is. What I've seen a challenge with in those conversations specifically, where it's an independent repair facility talking to a dealer showing, is that the independent repair facility doesn't really understand, just specific examples I've seen, the IRF doesn't understand the process completely, and they're looking for the dealer to understand, to try and help to enforce it or understand it. But the dealer hears it in a way that it's not clear. It's miscommunication. A lot of this stuff comes down to miscommunication. So what you should walk away with today is the connection here. That for Toyota training, put that pen and paper to work, crrtraining.com. For Toyota repair information, techinfo.toyota.com. And make the connection to us directly if there's any questions.
Questions?
I just had a quick question. When we send our techs to the Toyota training that is available now, do we get access, if we have certified techs at our independent facilities, do we have access then to Toyota's repair manuals, or do we have to subscribe as well?
Yeah, no, you get it. So if you're an independent repair facility, the key, man, I forgot to mention this to the first session. Bob, can we get them all back? The key is a connection to your dealer. That's very important. So independent repair facility, you're buying parts from a dealer, right, to fix our Toyota and Lexus vehicles. That's where it starts. The dealer has to sponsor you. Whenever they sponsor you to come to training, they get the information to give you the repair information at the same time. So repair information right now is available at three different levels. Typically, you can buy it for 2 days, you can buy it for 1 month, you can buy it for a full year. The most expensive that you would pay out of pocket for it is $400 for a year's worth of all the repair information, training manuals, owner's manuals, the technical bulletins, every piece of repair information that we provide. So it's $400 per year maximum you'll pay. But if you partner up with your dealer and they sponsor you to come to training, you get access to all of that repair information at the same time, no cost. Yeah.
We've noticed in our region, and I think across Canada, it's fairly consistent, dealers are extremely resistant to sponsoring and isolating a shop to be certified. So is there any sort of corporate a corporate mandate that you guys are looking at in the future to open up? Because those 39 shops you talk about doing it wrong, the one doing it right isn't the dealer body shop. I kid you not, in most regions, there's definitely an independent or an MSO that is doing a way better job of following repair procedures, training their techs, and doing all that. And the dealers, many who don't have collision centers, are still like, we don't want you to stand out in the crowd, even though you're willing to invest the time and the money to train your staff to repair to those standards. So I don't know if any of you can speak to that.
Are you talking to Toyota specifically?
Toyota, Audi.
If that's the case with Toyota, you call us at headquarters. That website again, crrtraining.com. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You'll find our contact information. You call us, we'll call the dealer on your behalf to explain what's going on, try and understand. Again, the reasons are many, right? The sponsorship by the dealer takes on some responsibility. Maybe they don't understand that responsibility. Maybe they don't want to take it. We had one instance where a dealer said, you know, we understand that they want us to sponsor them, but guess what? They haven't paid their parts bill in 3 months. Well.
Obviously,
we're not going to do it.
Totally,
so the reasons are many. Maybe it's a misunderstanding, but what we're offering is you reach out to us, and we will get in the middle and say, hey, what's going on? You know, we want to support you. Sometimes they don't understand the value of it, right? And the value leads back to the brand reputation of no matter who fixes our car, and they can have to go back to the dealer to buy a car. So if they wanted to buy another Toyota car, then it behooves all of us to.
Audi specifically is on our radars locally because we have something like 300 miles to the closest Audi certified collision center. And I mean, Audi is at the forefront of aluminum technology, and there's literally year over year over year, Audi's coming out with new cars, and there's literally nobody certified to fix them.
That's not necessarily true. I don't run the program in Canada, though I do support them.
Yeah.
We do support them with training. Gentleman by the name of Scott Weidman, Volkswagen Group. It's so important to us in the U.S., and Scott followed suit, that every dealer must have, as part of dealer standard, a certified body shop. If they don't, it's a question on their standards assessment that at the end of the year, they could very well lose a lot of bonus money. So we've put the skin in the game that you need to do this, whether it's independent or you own it, but there needs to be a true relationship between the body shop and you, and that's how it is. Now in Canada, yeah, there's probably 40 body shops across Canada for Audi, and they're strategically placed to handle the vehicles. We typically look where vehicles live and where they should be repaired and have a presence. So that's a budding program up there, but I think it's pretty robust for what we have. We spend a lot of time with MPI working with them as well.
All right, let's talk a little bit about repairs and repair procedures. Nissan recently issued a position statement saying that no repair should be done on rear bumper covers in the general area of the side radar. So do you guys have a similar position statement? And if not, do you address those repairs in your repair manuals, repair information?
So for Toyota, we are actually going to avoid putting a position statement out that says don't repair bumpers for blind spot monitoring. We're going to avoid putting that position statement out because the information is in the repair manual. We'd like you to use the repair manual information. And this document in front of me, I'm really proud of because it was an improvement in the repair manual based on feedback that we had from you all in regards to blind spot monitoring and bumper repairs. The feedback that we got was, what does this information mean? I can't modify the bumper in the area around the blind spot monitor sensor. Modify area around, it was all kind of vague. So this is the new procedure, because we went back to the folks that in Japan that make the repair procedures, and we said, this is too vague, we need more support, can you please help? So this is the improved procedure, and it actually gives measurements for the bumper. I know it's hard to see, and I'm gonna leave this up here for you all to see, but it's in the technical information available to you today. 2018 Camry is the first model, and it's gonna grow from there. But these measurements, this gray shaded area, those are the measurements on the bumper which you may or may not be able to repair. Now, may or may not be able to repair, we get deeper into what's an acceptable repair, what's not an acceptable repair. This section calls out gouges. If it's gouged, the bumper is gouged, can you repair it? Can you not repair it? What are the specifications available? This section calls out paint application. Can you blend in that area? Does it have to be a full coat? What does the thickness have to be? So on and so forth. All the specifications for that bumper repair to make sure the blind spot monitoring still works are right there in the repair information.
Now, one of the reasons I came to this meeting is to know more about the advances and some of the technology. I noticed you have a windshield displayed here. I'd like to see who's going to talk about that.
Well, great. Thanks. Perfect. Richard, go ahead and talk about the windshield, the technology behind that.
Well, you know, as the technology changes constantly, this is just one brief example of our vehicles when I say our vehicles, I mean most of the vehicles nowadays produce just technology on the windshield there. We have three or four sensors, depends on which model you buy, and each sensor does its individual performance. So the technology there is incredible. Of course, we have the technology also for the rear monitoring camera, the sight, sonar sensors, and so forth. It's just, it's overwhelming is what it is with technology. It's just, I can't even keep up with it, to tell you the truth. And, you know, I just work for Mazda, and you folks work for many OEs that you repair the shops. I sometimes wonder how you keep up with all this upcoming technology.
Well, let's talk about more technology. You know, over the last few years, we've seen a lot of different types of materials being introduced that you guys have to deal with, and not only ultra-high strength steel, but aluminums, carbon fiber, magnesium, you name it, as coming into your shop, you gotta know how to fix it. And Audi's kind of up in the game on that. Their new A8, I don't know if any of you saw the article recently about the new A8, but it's gonna have not only ultra-high strength steel, but aluminum, carbon fiber, magnesium, and just to add a cherry on top, there's gonna be 14 different ways to join the body together. So we'll offer you some support on the way out so you don't get beat up. But we have a video to show you about that car and about the different types of material that we're gonna go ahead and roll to give you an example of what's coming up. Okay, so Mark, do you want to explain why you're doing this to us? Seriously, I'm pretty sure it's because of weight, structural rigidity, all that kind of stuff, but go ahead and tell them why you're,
nah,
you're doing
we
this.
We just want to keep them guessing and changing.
That's
everything.
Pretty much what they're thinking.
Yeah. It makes it worth waking up every day.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, for me it does. I enjoy going to work every day. Realistically, you know, if you look at Audi as a brand, we started producing all aluminum cars back in 1992. So weight has always been a concern of ours from performance aspect, as well as being able to deliver on other promises of safety and, excuse me, gas mileage. So as we've developed as a brand, we're pushing the envelope of where we need to go with these structures and still be exciting and really fun cars to drive. So we're responding to regulatory pressures and customer demands that we have felt over the past 8 to 10 years in developing this. And I think we've come up with some really cool, innovative solutions. Now, this is Audi, and as I talk with our insurance partners, this is us now. The fact of the matter is, as these regulations maintain or increase, a lot of other manufacturers are going to start following suit with mixed materials and structures that are much more complex than we're used to of seeing in mild steel and frame on body on frame construction. So we're here now, and not everybody's going to follow us exactly, but if you look at where we all have to go with the regulations, this is what we have. These structures are adaptable so that they can accommodate many different drive lines, including full electric and hybrid, and we're giving you a much better product. Kind of the cool thing is when we have guests at our training center, the old version of A8, two people could pick it up and carry it across the parking lot in a body, as you see, body and weight, as you see there. So super lightweight structure, a lot of the weight comes from driveline and creature comfort things. So we had to redesign our program. We classically were steel and aluminum, and 2.5 years ago we announced the Q7, and that was the first of the hybrid construction materials, with 41% being aluminum and the other 59% being steel. That was a groundbreaking change in the way that we had to equip and train our certified shops, but also how we communicate to the world, including the insurance companies, the needs of that vehicle in the repair. So things are changing rapidly, and when you're putting so many dissimilar materials together, repair process plan and following that is going to be super important, because some of those materials like to corrode the other materials. Things like adhesives and e-coats and final coats are imperative to follow those processes, because you may cause structural problems. Now throw in on top of that the special tools required to take and run a rivet through aluminum, high-strength steel, and ultra-advanced high-strength steel, and that's probably why we're using a much different riveter than what other folks in the industry are using. There are a lot more requirements. So these things will be changing when you're looking to put different material stacks together of steels, mild high strength and ultra advanced high strength. The welders become super important. So I beat up on them a little bit, but you're not gonna get away with your Harbor Freight spot welder. You need to do your diligence as a business and look at what are the cars that I repair, and then what are the tools and equipment that are required to repair it, because there's proprietary programming in those machines to have their technology come up and do an acceptable weld for those repairs.
Well, now I'm sure they're saying, well, that's great, but I got to have all these different welders, all these different types of tools, equipment, materials, things like that. And we heard some talk recently about the OEs having some collaborative efforts between you all to maybe come together on some types of equipment, some types of materials, things like that, to help these guys, not put out as much money, you might say, on all this separate kind of equipment and making choices on what kind of cars they fix. So, what are you guys doing in that respect?
Before we get too far away from being prepared to work on mixed materials, one, I'll jokingly say that Toyota is going to go kicking and screaming from what I've seen. Right? You know, we are going to have to incorporate aluminum eventually to meet all of the fuel economy demands. In the meantime, we're going ultra-high-strength steel, right? Every model that comes out has more and more ultra-high-strength steel because it's lighter, and we're able to maintain the the structural integrity of the cars. The key point that I wanted to catch on before we go too much further is have no fear. The information is going to be available to you before you need it. The training is going to be available to you before you need it. Mark, in the last session, you talked about the development of your training and the preparation for these mixed materials that are coming out. How far ahead does that happen?
So typically, we go a year and a half, 2 years before the car comes to the U.S. market for training. We bring Sean Hart and Thomas Maldemar, who's our trainers, and I go over for training in Germany. We train on these bodies, and then we bring it back here, develop our course, and we have that content typically a year and a half, 2 years ahead of time. So we're well prepared to deliver those courses as soon as we can get a release to the market and start having those cars fixed. To your point, the damage starts when the first car leaves the factory, hits that rail head, and starts going to the port.
So we know we can't start training after the car hits your dealership.
Right. Right?
So your responsibility, where you're going to have to take some initiative here, is keeping your nose to the ground on what's going on. Pay attention to trade publications. Pay attention to our OE websites, our training classes that are coming out. Man, why does Audi have this new training class on magnesium repairs for, there's no magnesium, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Right, try and stay ahead of the game by being aware, doing exactly what you're doing here, coming to the PPG MVP conferences, and stay ahead. Don't wait until that car is launched and the first one comes into your shop to try and figure out how to repair it.
Let's talk a little bit about training ROI, because a lot of these guys are thinking, you know, I gotta train all these people all the time. What's my return on investment for all that training? Because I'm kind of afraid this guy might leave me and go to my competitors. There's always that fear out there. So talk a little bit about how necessary it is, not only the ROI on training, but the fact is that you have to, you know, you have to constantly train now. It's not a one and done. It's like an ongoing thing to keep current, not only just catch up, but to keep current.
Eric made a great point. That very first repair, that car comes in there and you have the training, your ROI begins. But there's a cultural change that happens when you start going to a manufacturer's training, be it Toyota or Mazda or Audi, is there's a support group that starts to happen. These technicians talk to each other, they start exchanging phone numbers, and we're there to support them all the way through. We get texts and emails from them all the time, phone calls. But they start cross-training each other. Hey, I forgot what happened. What did Sean say in that class? I can't remember. How do I do it? We see this happening all the time. It changes the way they work and their pride. So ROI, if you look at it at pure dollars, it's kind of like taking a wad of money and putting it in a CD, because it's easy, but you're not only going to get about 0.5% interest on it. Or are you going to proactively put it in a money account where you're going to get 3%, right? It takes that little bit of management. I would say training and technicians are as important to you as an asset as the equipment, the hard stuff. So if in that culture, that desire to want to learn, that in itself is some compensation. And to hold that person there may take a little compensation, but the pride that they get in doing their job is huge.
Bob, I'll approach it a little bit differently. We use the word training and education synonymously, and they're actually quite different. You know, I think before you jump into training and the ROI, folks need to decide, you know, to get educated on what they want to train on. You know, today's cars are becoming more and more complex, as we know. Mark talks about specializing. Based on certain manufacturers, perhaps it might even come down to substrates or different parts of the process. But repairs over the years had to make decisions about glass, about PDR, about interiors. I mean, I can go on and on. Tires, alignments. I mean, there's some shops that take that stuff in house. There's some shops that decide they're going to outsource that. I think the education part of the process is decide what you're going to be really good at, and then invest in the training to be the best at it. But this idea that you're going to train for training's sake, my concern with that is that's where you see the ROI perhaps not be realized, because training a little bit on everything It doesn't necessarily give you a good result at the end. Right. So decide what you're going to focus on. And it can be make specific, or it might be the types of metals you're working on. It could be hybrids, electrics, whatever you decide you're going to do, and be the best at it. And then decide, I make that decision every day in my business. You know, I'm a technology company, but I outsource all my laptops and computer support in our data center. I'm not trying to get into things that somebody else spends their day doing. I focus on the things that I can be really good at and try to be the best at it.
Great point. Question over here.
Is Audi going to be mandating training for estimators?
Great question. We were just talking about that on the break. We've been limited on capacity. Originally, we started with ICAR doing our training, and we feel that there's still a lot of value from ICAR, but we only got 6 weeks of training available a year, and then we opened our first collision training center, and they came in droves. So we gave just about 500 students worth of training for technicians last year. Hopefully by June, we'll have our Ontario, California operation up and offer training there, and that'll allow us some additional capacity. So that's a later this year, beginning next year project where we can start offering out updated training to the front end of the business, you know, the estimators, the managers, and the blueprinters, so that we give a better, more complete program. And in that also has to be the partners that you have, and that's the folks from the dealer's service and parts department, because they have to integrate as part of the team as well.
Thank you. Okay, let's switch gears a little bit and talk about recalibration, because we haven't touched on that yet. Now, the systems needing recalibrated after a collision really are not always evident because they're either located away from the impact area, nobody's looking there, or they're disturbed or even disconnected during the repair process. So can you guys share any best practices with when a car comes into the shop? You know, what are the best practices to make sure we don't miss any systems that need to be recalibrated?
As with training, development of a training course, our calibration method and procedures, they're taking into account the vehicle being in a service shop or in a collision body shop atmosphere. So those procedures are then worked into that facility, such as yours. We always try to keep that in mind so it's not as disturbance as possible. However, once you do the calibration, some of our vehicles, along with our partners here, require that they be driven to confirm that the problem has been repaired and the check engine light doesn't come on, and also to meet certain cycle applications of that component. Again, it's all those repair procedures are not a mystery. They are in our service information.
The repair information, right? We're talking about best practices. Go to the repair manual, find out what the repair information calls for that system that you're working on. I have another document in front of me. It comes right out of the repair manual for a Camry again. Procedures necessary when battery terminal is disconnected, reconnected. This is all the procedures that are necessary whenever you do a disconnect, reconnect of the battery, including calibrations, initializations, right? And the build sheet data to identify systems on the car is available in the same TIS subscription, same place. There's another tab over there for vehicle inquiry. You type in the VIN, and it pulls up all of the build sheet data for that vehicle.
Yeah. Oh, just one sure. Comment real quick. I want to piggyback on Eric. He mentioned build data. I'm sure that most of us know what he's referring to, but that is such a powerful, that is a birth certificate of that vehicle. I mean, that document will tell you what it came from the factory. It's essential that you know how that vehicle came. A quick example is this windshield here. If that customer or that body shop would have scanned the vehicle or looked at the build data, he would have found out which of the maybe three or four windshields are available for that car. And they're all a little bit different. On the aftermarket side, of course, they may or may not have that information. If they don't, they'll order a windshield, install on a vehicle. This is a true example I gave in the first session is, it came in just for a glass replacement, front windshield. aftermarket, one was placed, which is okay. There's nothing wrong with the aftermarket, but so be it. They install aftermarket, and that customer was driving and got rear-ended by a vehicle because the vehicle broke automatically without having to do so, because the windshield that was installed didn't have the right angle on the, there's a black center piece that you see from viewing the glass or the windshield. That's actually a plastic bracket where all the components are attached onto. That bracket was off just by maybe a millimeter or so, which gave the wrong reading. So when the customer was driving, the input was that was incorrect, and the vehicle thought that it was time to brake. And that difference could be, well, in this case, it turned out to be another accident, and fortunately, I don't think the person was hurt, but that's just one example of knowing exactly what parts to order, because these vehicles are, again, becoming complicated with different components for different models, and you have to know exactly which part to order.
Doug?
We talked at the last session about the road test and the importance of it, and the reason that some of these systems will not reinitialize until certain conditions are met. So we get asked all the time, you know, in a post-repair scan, wouldn't the scan tools pick that up? Wouldn't you be able to find these fault codes? And what I've tried to communicate to the industry is that some of these fault codes won't actually kick off until certain conditions are met. So the road test is a critical piece of your whole delivery process. It's not necessarily viewed that way today, but if you're not doing those, your customer is in fact going to be doing your QA for you in real time in live traffic. And my concern with a lot of these ADAS systems is that, you know, we might look at it as new and different, but there are generations out there that'll quickly trust what the car is supposed to do to the point where they will blame the car when it doesn't behave the way it behaved prior to the accident.
Right.
So the only way you'll know if those systems are in fact reinitialized is if you actually put it through its paces. So that's something to remember.
Well, you know, in the past it's always been, hey, the accident wasn't my fault, and now it may be true. You'll get to that point.
Yeah, the car doesn't lie. I mean, there is DNA all throughout that car in the repair process. We find a large percentage of fault codes get introduced during the repair process. And although, assuming the car's fixed and put back correctly and they become historical in nature and enough key cycles occur, they may eventually drop. The truth is there's fingerprints everywhere in that thing. So somebody after the accident, if it is a question mark, my point to repairs is make sure you don't leave any traces, right? But you just basically finish and make it an invisible repair. And that includes ensuring that none of those fault codes are active when it leaves.
Right, I'll just stay with you because a lot of our customers think it's a good idea to have asTech do the scanning. You know, you get a receipt and everything for it. And but are there any issues with scanning a vehicle remotely when the technician's not really at the car? Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, so, you know, I'll just go back to the earlier discussion we had in the previous session about aftermarket tools. There are a lot of good aftermarket tools out there.
Yep.
They typically improve as cars get older. So when you think about the market for those, they're designed typically for mechanical shops. The collision industry is a fairly small industry in the whole automotive ecosystem. And the issue with collision repairs, you're getting new cars as they come off the assembly line, right? So you're getting the 16s, the 17s, the soon to be 18s. And so we opt to use the factory scan tools on our side. But to answer Bob's question directly, there are limitations when you do that remotely. Obviously, we have to rely on the person on the other end to be truthful with us as to what's actually going on with that vehicle. A simple example might be battery support. We're dogged that car has to have proper battery support during the diagnostic process. Cars are engineered that when they start losing power, they shut down systems. That's a safety feature. It's to keep that car operating correctly. And so we'll throw off false fault codes if that car's not being properly supported. So we put a technology in that we can actually read the voltage in our end and tell if the shop's being truthful or not. But there are certain limitations as well with the technician that's on the other side as to what they can and can't do, and certain limitations with that. So what we've done is, with our larger clients, is we've actually started to put in-house technicians to help with the workflow, to help with the actual process. But that also led us to realize that there are certain repair procedures that some organizations just aren't equipped for, whether it's a complete wiring harness repair, wiring replacement, a removal of dashboards, steering columns. So what we've opted to do is, we announced this last week, is we've bought mobile companies throughout the U.S. We're going to expand that footprint. And our goal is to really bring support and solutions, basically fix what needs to be fixed on these cars when repairs get to that point where they don't know what they're looking at.
Thanks. Let's continue that a little bit about the ADAS systems. And, you know, when you go to calibrate or recalibrate these systems, some are as simple as just, like you said, driving the car around until it resets. And some of the systems, you have to have specialty tools, equipment, increased workspace around the car. So considering that the majority of the repairers fixing cars today are these guys, most of them are, you know, a lot of them are independent shops, a lot of trade associations have been calling for the Society of Automotive Engineers, or SAE, to develop some kind of a calibration standard to make it more standard. So do you guys believe an SAE calibration standard is feasible between automakers?
I'll take that one. I think so. I mean, realistically, if you look at what comes out of the OBD2 port, all the manufacturers are engaged in what comes out of OBD2 and standardizations. So at some point, I think, yes, we will get there. We're all at the table through different committees through SAE. It's just a matter of getting there and writing the right verbiage. So yeah, I think eventually we will get there. I don't know that it's going to be in the next year, but that's really up to SAE. Mm-hmm. The other thing to consider in all these recalibrations and all these code talks and everything else is 62. What does that mean? Right, you got a code. What are you going to do with it? So you got a code, and some of these older machines or non-main line dealership machines don't have the, they'll give you a diagnostic code, but what they won't give you is a guided fault finding and curing that code. So it's super important to be using, I will say, the OE's repair information, whether it's Otis or TIS or WIS or PWIS or whoever you're using. And it has to be the latest version, because a lot of the recalls or campaigns that we do have updates in software. And we went on a cadence where we were doing 2 updates a week. I mean, for that software to be updated is super important. So you're using the latest and greatest in your business, and you need to consider that when you're approaching this, because if you don't use the latest versions, you can cause more harm than you can repair. The other thought is, you also still have to have a technician that can follow basic electrical principle.
I was going to add to Mark's last point there, which is that the person operating that tool is as important as the tool itself. And that may sound like such an obvious statement, but these scan tools are designed typically for whole cars. You know, they're designed on the mechanical side to isolate a single problem. So something stops working, it goes down the decision tree, you do rule outs, and it'll tell you basically from that point forward what to do. Trouble in collision repair is that's not what happened, right? Your car is missing pieces, you got cut wires, blown fuses. That car may not even be able to communicate. Certain parts of that vehicle may be so badly damaged that you've lost communication. So you're in such a unique space, and it's so critical, the work that you do, that regardless of whether you use a service like ours, or whether you go to the dealer, or whether you use a mobile guy, or do it in-house, having that the right tool and the right tech, in my opinion, is a critical piece to this whole process. And whether you can train somebody to do everything, every make and model, every system, I'm not sure that's practical. But that's back to my point earlier. Pick what it is you're going to do real well, and then partner for the rest.
Well, another good point, I think, is the fact that most of us would look in collision repair procedures for recalibration, but you're talking to going into the mechanical service procedures as well, because most of that stuff relates to the mechanical, correct?
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
Let's talk, a resource I'd like to make you all aware of, using Toyota's OE information and Toyota's scan tools, all that stuff works together, so you pull 62. Whenever you're doing the scan tool diagnostic, and that 62 actually turns into a blue hyperlink. You click on the blue hyperlink, it runs you right into the repair information and tells you you know, how to go through the diagnostic path. To these gentlemen's point, you still do need the training, the background to know how to follow that through, how to use a DVOM and all of those things. But the tools are in place to work together to help a skilled technician get through that diagnostic path successfully the first time.
Yeah. I'd share an anecdote with you, sorry.
No, go ahead, Brian.
That we shared earlier. So we run a technician's, mechanical technician's program called Twin Cup, and basically it starts off like the Olympics. It's regional, then national, then goes to international. So we take a bunch of cars and we throw bugs in them, and we used my personal assigned car for the test. And I'm standing there as a proctor watching some new Audi technicians that had some promise go and diagnose my car. And they pulled 62, and well, then they didn't follow the guided fault finding, and I started to watch my dashboard come out of my car. The fault was we bugged a fuse and we put it in the wrong spot. So the technician not only didn't follow the guided fault finding, but didn't go to basic electrical theory and do a conductivity test on the fuse. Had another one that found the fuses that were reversed, but then that caused another issue, didn't realize it, and he started taking the fuse panel out of the back of my car. All the while, I can't say anything, and I'm going, oh, God, I got to drive this thing home. I got to fix it before I can drive it home. So you can really go down the wrong way. Great point. Specialize in what you're good at, and then let the other people do the rest.
Obviously, that technician wasn't no longer promising, I suppose.
No, we sent him back with some homework.
One thing, Bob, on the scan tool, kind of to summarize it. These scan tools are made, they're very durable. Pretty much trouble-free. I'm not trying to sell you one, but they are very trouble-free. However, without the right training, you could easily blank the PCM, the power control module, and that is basically the brain of the vehicle. Those modules, don't quote me on these prices, but they're a few thousand bucks, and definitely you wouldn't want that on your bill as far as added onto the repair. They got to be, these tools got to be used the way they're intended to use, and if they're not used correctly, again, they will blank out computers, and you need another computer. Some OEs have a recovery process, but you have to send it in, wait X amount of days, and that's critical in your business. I just want to mention that warning.
Well, this brings up a good point, too, because a lot of vehicles today have onboard computers that track, you know, when a DTC was thrown, diagnostic trouble code was thrown, such as key cycle data, freeze frame data, all that stuff. How can and should that data be used by a repairer or a technician before you completely wipe it out?
Record history first.
Yeah. Okay.
And don't wipe it out until you know that you have the faults cleared. And that was part of that whole process with that technician was document.
Sure.
What I found is the problem, how I looked up the history, recorded the history, what the corrective issues or the corrective actions were taken, recording that into the history as well, so that it can also be downloaded to the customer or shared with the customer what those repairs were, and then clear the codes. But you have to go through this process, or if you just clear codes, well, guess what? They might come back, and we may not know why if nobody bothered to record history.
By the way, we say that in the repair procedures, again, for Toyota oftentimes. This one in front of me, freeze frame data, description, when a pre-collision system DTC is stored, the millimeter wave radar sensor assembly stores the current vehicle ECU or sensor state as freeze frame data, and then gives you the procedure on how to collect that freeze frame data. Connect the text stream, turn the ignition on. I won't bore you with the rest. You'll even see some that say, hint, do not disconnect the battery before collecting this data. The information's in the repair manual.
Great point. Vehicle voltage is key.
Yeah.
So in our case, the first thing the technician needs to do is put the battery minder on it and charger so that it always has perfect system voltage. If you don't have that, you can be pulling erroneous codes out of it.
Yeah, I made the comment earlier about how some of these codes require certain key cycles or drive conditions to occur. And so we'll have clients of ours that'll think they're doing us a favor by, you know, wiping out the codes and then calling up and saying, okay, what's coming back? And without that vehicle having back through its paces again, you just can't read trouble codes. I mean, there may be an active condition, but it won't, again, surface until sometime downstream.
This extra paperwork or the extra time, you know, we ask you to do according to our repair procedures, it's for your own benefit. It's your insurance to tell and show the insurance company, the customer, or even internal, what was done to this vehicle. And that saves you so much time and headache. Just record the information down. It's for you.
You know, I was as little skeptical as anybody would be because it's new. And anytime there's change, there's always questions. One of the first cars we did, it was a 2015 Ford Fusion, had a $7,500 hit in the front, little suspension damage, one light on. And we scanned the car on the pre-scan, and it came up that there were 14 codes in 8 different modules, and 4 of them, if we hadn't done that, would, just by turning the light off, we would have never caught. So I'll say it's pretty incredible. I definitely think, I mean, I look at it, my company fixed 52,000 cars last year. So I lay at in bed that night thinking to myself from the year prior, how many of those cars went home that appeared right and there were no lights on, but really weren't right?
Sure.
So, you know, Doug, so far so good. It's pretty amazing. So if you think that you're doing everything right, you probably want to really take a look at what you're doing and how you're doing it and what tools you're doing it with.
Yeah, that's an awesome point because, you know, let's talk a little bit about pre and post scan. We don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but the question really is, do the shops have a potential liability issue when they don't do what they should be doing to the customer, for example? There's got to be something going on there, Doug.
Is asTech saving all that data on the pre-scans, post-scans?
Yeah, we actually, in addition to sending that to the repair shop, we have a repository. So if you lose it for any reason or need to come back to it, now we don't share it with any other parties, so just so we're clear, we're not sending out to third-party data aggregators. It all stays in-house. But you have access to that in our server, right? So we're not disposing that. But as far as liability is concerned, Ford's come out with an app. Hyundai's got one. The new Acuras and the infotainment system will actually show the DTCs on the infotainment system. My premise, and I think it's been proven so far, is that the consumer, the person you're dealing with every day, is going to have more information flash up on their smartphone when they drive off your lots going forward than maybe even your own staff do. And so this idea that, you know, informed consumers are a two-sided edge there. It's great in the repair planning process when they know what they're signing up for. But at the end of this repair process, don't be surprised if they come back to you and show you their smartphone and say, these codes weren't there when I brought it in here, right? And hopefully they come to you instead of a trial attorney or even call the insurance company. So my point with all this is I think it's critical that we as repairers understand that it's ours unless we can prove otherwise. I mean, it's supposed to be you're innocent until proven guilty, but it wasn't an accident. And so everybody, you know, this happens today, even without all this digital age, people have said, oh, it wasn't there before the accident. Well, now the car's actually keeping record of it and tracking it. Sure. And there's date stamps in some of these. Audi does a good job with the historical freeze frame data. We had one there where a module for the sunroof had gone bad 9 months before the accident. And, you know, we were able to find that through the freeze frame data. Audi had a recall on it. There was a water line that came off the sunroof and actually caused that to short out. Anyways, the point is, got fixed correctly. The insurance company didn't pay for something that wasn't accident related. And it was all because the work was being done up front to actually understand what was needed for that repair.
I mean, what better way to have someone get denied a claim on something because it didn't happen during the accident than to find some information where there's an actual recall that's going to get paid for by the manufacturer? Everybody's happy. They don't care. The customer doesn't care where the payment came from as long as it was covered in a recall or something like that. That's the important point here, to find that information. Okay, something a little touchier is that in 2016, NHTSA, the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, Well, they were putting together some guidance for automotive safety system technology, defects in particular to those technologies, solicited public comments for a final enforcement guide and bulletin on system technology. So some suggestions that came in said that the automotive safety technologies themselves should not create unreasonable risk to safety due to, among a lot of other things, impractical recalibration standards, what we have to do to recalibrate these cars. So NHTSA agreed and said that these impractical calibration standards may constitute a safety-related defect. So have you guys heard about this? Are you doing anything about it? Because NHTSA could actually come back and say, because your cars are so difficult to recalibrate, that in and of itself is considered a defect.
Yes. NHTSA likes to point out a lot of things, but take responsibility for little, don't they?
Government, it's government.
They're actually responsible for the collision repair segment, but don't bother to delve in there. Realistically, yeah, I mean, and this is, as you look going forward with autonomous vehicles, there was also an article that suggested that NHTSA wisely looked at some other segments of autonomy, be it construction equipment, like mining equipment, and aircraft industry. And the article was based in that they think there will be more service business with autonomous cars, not less, because the calibrations and system checks need to be done more frequently to avoid accidents. So it's kind of a double-edged sword there. Yeah, we have to come to an agreement, manufacturers, NHTSA, and insurers and alike, repairers, that this is going to be something that is part of normal day life. So we gave up oil changes and the springtime tune-up and the winter tune-up and the exchange of tires for this. I mean, that's where it was when I first came into the business. And if you look at where we're going, it seems to be the case.
So listening through the implications and all the lines of text there, what I hear at the heart of that message is our vehicles need to be easy to repair, need to be easy to calibrate, right? So my call to action for all of you is, if you find a procedure on a Toyota vehicle that is difficult to perform, calibration or otherwise, click on the Submit Correction button on TIS and tell us about it. Because one, we need to know about it if we don't already, and two, the more reports that we have is more support to get that improved, changed, et cetera. And I guess there's always a possibility that maybe it's a miscommunication, a misunderstanding on your side, and we just need to help you out.
You know, I think what we're witnessing with different government agencies weighing in on this is just how new and evolving this whole issue is. So on autonomous driving, for instance, the Department of Transportation put out a paper that said, you know, there's 12 factors that go into a level 4, level 5 vehicle. And the item number 9 was that following a collision, the car needed to be certified that it was actually fit for use and conformed to OEM standards. So I get the idea of wanting to simplify things, but on the other hand, if those systems don't work, that car won't be allowed to go back into the fleet, so to speak. So I think that's the state we're at. I think it's changing so quickly. I think the manufacturers are, to some extent, conflicted. They want to put all this new technology in because that's what the consumers required to do, you know, requiring of them, and they want to be competitive. But then in the service end of it, you're having to figure out how to basically take care of all this stuff once it gets on the vehicle. Yeah. And that's a real challenge. I mean, there's a company out in California called Faraday. I don't want to spend too much time on them, but somebody in their organization thought putting facial recognition in the B pillar was kind of a cool thing. And I'm sitting back thinking, how many in this room would know where to start with something like that? And so all this cool stuff that makes it onto a car ultimately has to be fixed somewhere down the stream. And us as repairers get the receiving end of it. We get the new cars that are in the worst possible condition and we're being asked to put them back as new conditions. So forecast calls for more, I guess, is really what I see.
If we can only get these guys to kind of hold things up for 5 years just to give us a chance to catch up a little bit, that'd be great. I know your customers like cool stuff and everything, but we're having a hard time dealing with it. So take that back and see
what
that gets you.
What holds the record on the Nürburgring, an RS7 autonomously piloted. First lap, it was slower than the human driver. Second lap, it was as fast. Third lap, it was faster.
So you're taking all the fun out of it is what you're doing.
Well, yeah. But, you know, I mean, seriously, look back at all of these systems. And I worked for another German luxury brand. And if you look at adaptive cruise control and what its origins were, if you want to take an interesting walk through history, that goes back into the late 60s, early 70s. And that little radar camera that you're now replacing on the front of the car used to be the size of a beer cooler. Literally, they used a beer cooler that they mounted on front of the car. So ease of adjusting this is adaptation of what the technology is, what we pull from the military. And there's a lot of concern about that as well as, you know, those systems' hackability. So that's a whole another topic.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, I look back and thought, you know, I used to really like to drive, and I couldn't figure out why I don't really like to drive anymore, and it's just not fun anymore. I mean, when I got in a 70 Cuda with a really fast engine and really bad brakes and bad suspension, I could smell the gas and the brake fluid while I was driving. I was pretty sure I could be killed in this today, you know, and that's what excited me about it. Today, just, okay, push it and let it do itself and just go. I mean, you know, okay, so I'm not spilling my coffee, but some things are just not as fun. That's all I'm saying. All right, let's talk about one more thing, and this is kind of an important topic too, is equipment upgrades. And I know that, you know, vehicle designs changed a lot in the last 10 years, and, you know, along with the equipment it takes to fix those cars. So, you know, how much equipment upgrading are you guys seeing in your shops, and what do you think should be done? Is there too much old stuff out there, or is it fine?
You guys want to go first?
Oh, we're boring.
Oh.
You go for it. So really quick to finish up on that, we haven't seen a lot of equipment upgrades in the past few years. Again, we're kicking and screaming into the mixed material stuff, and even on one model that we have coming out with aluminum structural components, the LC, the part's only going to be available to be replaced at a steel joint using the same welding and repair procedures that have been available on our vehicles for years. So when we come out with those equipment demands and training demands, we'll let you know about it well ahead of time.
Yeah.
Yes, Rich.
Just before Mark gets beat up on this, same as Toyota, you know, Mazda's gradually modifying and changing as we move forward. Definitely not as dramatic changes as Audi. Of course, they have beautiful cars and metals and processes. We're not there yet. We are going there, but we take it a little bit slower. So there's not much massive change in equipment as we have it now. It's gradual change. And with that, I'll leave that to Mark.
So I think before we talk about my beloved brands, because I also get to take care of Lamborghini and Bentley, so they have great stuff too. You have to look at general accounting principle. I mean, realistically, you should be writing your equipment off 5 to 7 years and reinvesting. And that's not a bad thing. I think you have to look at your business and say, the welder I started with 30 some odd years ago isn't the one that's relevant now. It still works, but it's not doing what it should. It's an investment. It's an investment of time. It's an investment of people. It's an investment of training. I could still use a rock, two trees that come along and bang something into place. That's not right for the materials that the vehicles are being manufactured for any of us. So based on Q7, 2.5 years ago, I told my network that they had to spend another $100,000 for an aluminum room and a specialized water drop vacuum that prevents the two major components of a thermite bomb from getting together in a very unhealthy way and blowing up our technicians. If you look at carbon fiber, there's a health concern in inhaling it, so you need to be concerned about that. the aluminum room does a lot more than just prevent cross-contamination. If you've ever been to an indoor batting cage where they have the big nets up, the ball hits the net and the energy is dispersed. Well, same theory. If there's an explosion in the bay, it takes and disperses the energy and prevents it from blowing the room up. So that's why we're saying the curtains. The other thing it does is there is a fire retardant material that has a reflective thread that's sewn into it, very much like a photographer's flash screen. And what it's made to do is integrate with the daylight lights that are at the top of the bay, reflect that light down off of the curtain, and we suggest painting the floor a light gray. And it gives you a very shadowless environment. So you can see when we, at our training center, we have bodies in white, so they've never been painted. They were rejected off the line. When you put them in that room, you can actually see where the material moved going through the stamping dies. So it's going to give you a much better repair because the technician now can see the imperfections where in the dungeon that one of our shops used to have, you wouldn't be able to see the imperfections. So it's about upgrading for materials, but it's also about upgrading for the work environment for the technician.
All right, thanks, guys. And we're just about close to the end here. And just before we do finish, any final comments from you guys? Well, you're all thinking of any final questions you want to ask them, so go ahead.
Yeah, final comment is that, like we said in the last session, we came here to tell you, to ask you, to practically beg you to use the repair information, use the repair resources that we're making available to you to make your repair decisions, to support your repair decisions to the bill payers, so on and so forth. They're out there. Please use them. If you have any questions about them, reach out to us and ask.
Gentlemen, anything? Good.
If you need us up, there's a question at the back. If you need us, we're here.
Question way in the back there.
On that website, the OEM One Stop, Audi's comment says that Audi does not support the repair of Audi vehicles with recycled vehicle parts or assemblies.
Mm-hmm.
Explain, does not support. Does that say don't use them? You don't support? I mean.
So everything we do has to go through legal review.
Sure.
And if you're asking me to say absolutely not, I would love to, but I have to work with our corporate counsel, who I like to keep on my side. So, no, we do not. We have those conversations with insurers and repairers alike, and no, we don't feel it's the right thing to do.
Thank you.
Thank you. One over here.
Yeah, while the mic's traveling, I'll pile on a little bit there. Now, there are free trade laws that prohibit us from making you use OEM parts, and from making you follow our repair procedures. Therefore, you can do otherwise. You know, we can't legally force you to do those things. But if you're doing so, you're doing them against our recommendations. And our recommendations are seated in returning a vehicle to a customer that meets our repair specifications.
Well, you have to understand, we walk a fine legal line. To pile on, and I'm sorry, I just want to cut in for 1 minute. We have an insurer that has a research group, and we're interactive with them. And they come to our training. We have a healthy relationship. Sometimes that includes disagreement. But they came up with an alternative repair plan using all OE parts, okay? And they felt that this was going to be a win for them because it would have saved, they'd had all the math. And okay, go for it. So they did. They did so with the support of equipment companies and adhesive companies. There was a lot of engineering behind this, okay? The result at IAHS really hasn't been shared out with the community, but it would have resulted in a fatality in a second repair. Here's my point. I'm not damning of them. I certainly support coming to a better way, but you had this much effort and engineering background by some very well equipped and trained people trying to come to an alternative outcome, and it failed. All we can tell you is we've tested our stuff, we've crash tested our stuff, this is what we used, and we know that we were able to validate it. So if you want to take that liability, given the laws that we deal with.
Hang on, we have a question over here that's been waiting.
Yeah, my question is for the Toyota people. Going back to the same question that he was asking, one of the things that I used to see when we used to be a Toyota certified shop, and with a Toyota rep used to come here, he will get upset when he used to see the, using the LQQ parts, and it was something that for us, like he was saying, we're being dictated by the insurance companies. Now the key word, what you guys were talking about, you know, is recommend. But on the pushback, when I used to work for Toyota, was that we could lose the certification on it. How's that working? Because it is a big deal. Because we're just a repair facility. We don't have no control. We have the insurance companies telling us one thing, and then we have the manufacturer telling us one thing, and we're in the middle. We don't have no way of defending ourselves either with the manufacturer nor with the insurance company. How can we handle that at a manufacturer level?
I'll just kind of answer that from my background. I know a little bit about insurance, and what's going to happen if a job goes sideways on you and you're going to say, well, the insurance company forced me to use these parts. The insurance company is going to say, hey, you're the expert. We just recommended something. They're not going to take liability for that repair because you know why? They're not fixing the car. You are. The liability is always on you. It's never on them. So insurance companies are never going to take the fall for a car that was repaired with parts that failed. That's just keep that in mind. If you guys want to add something to that.
I know from experience that this process of educating consumers and their cars and the need for the correct repair is never an easy one. But they have a very important voice in this whole equation, and too oftentimes they're overlooked. And we owe it to them to explain to them why it is there's some potential friction or difference of opinion on things and get their voice involved. And I have to tell you, it plays huge dividends. Now, for shops that are heavily vested in DRPs, that's a challenge because you could end up upsetting that relationship. But I've seen good repairers educate the consumer and say, this is not just like your medical, right? You got out of pocket. This isn't covered. Now, you could sit back and say, but their policy should. But if you explain to the consumer, hey, the right way to fix this is the following, and your carrier's going to pay you this, but the final bill is that, and here's the difference why. I've met shop owners that have done that, been very successful at it.
That makes a huge difference because it's the customer talking to the insurance company, their customer, not a shop talking to them. And believe me, agents that sell a lot of policies and make a lot of money on those policies, they get kind of, you know, prickly whenever their consumers are leaving them for another company. So it's a competitive business just like all of our businesses. So I agree with that. Get the consumer educated, have them go back and say, why aren't you paying what this thing needs to have done to it? And that'd probably be your best bet.
Any other websites that you could recommend to keep up with the updates and the technology in general, just because there seem to be so many of them?
Eric made a great point earlier, you know, online, Fender Bender, ABRN, SCRS, Repair Driven News. I mean, I'm reading it 2, 3, 4 times a day every time stuff comes in. Automotive News.
PPG. Collision Hub's
PPG,
another good one.
Yeah. Collision Link, SAE, and then you missed it again. We had great debate about talking about the topic du jour, and that's scanning. And we said, listen, we're welcome, we're more than willing to come and talk at a conference like this and talk to great people, but the realism of it is our touch is out only a couple hundred people, and we're very grateful that you're here and that you're listening to us for over 90 minutes now. But the ask of us back was, how do we get some discipleship? How do we get this out to the masses? So this is why it's being taped and put out through the PPG network on their website, so that we can get this message out and share with the repairers that are not in those chairs in the back. We need your help as much as we need your buy-in in terms of getting that message out and sharing this new technology and repair methodologies and ideas.
Excellent point. Anybody else? Okay, well, I want to thank our guests today. Let's give them a round of applause for coming out here for us.
Yeah. Another well-deserved thanks is for PPG for facilitating this, putting this on, giving us the opportunity to hear you, you the opportunity to hear us and ask questions. So thank
thanks.
You guys.
Appreciate it. Thanks. Thanks, everybody. Have a good rest of the conference.